Hi, this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike. Welcome to part 4 of Tradecraft, Social Engineering. In this lecture, we'll talk about how to disguise an attack package and deliver it to your target. We'll talk about physical media, watering hole attacks, how to create a phishing site, and spear phishing. Let's start with physical media. The idea is to take a CD or a USB stick and burn your attack package to it. Physical media works best when you have a plausible pretext. Let's say my target is the HR director. I can pretend that I'm an aspiring graphics artist applying for a job. That's my pretext. Now, on the media, I might put a Microsoft Office document that represents my resume with a macro in it. I might also put a .pdf.exe or .jpeg.exe or any kind of other file to look like it's something from my portfolio, but it's really something to give me code execution. It helps to have things that will support your attack and get code execution along with things designed to look legitimate. Once you have your physical media put together, mail it to your target, send it via FedEx, whatever you've got to do. But when they open it and plug it in, if you did everything else right, you'll get your session. Another social engineering option is the watering hole attack. The idea is this. There is a web server that people from your target organization regularly visit. Okay? One option you have as the attacker is to hack into that website in some way and get it to serve your malicious content. Now, in the future, when somebody from your target organization comes back, they'll get a little bit of extra value add. You'll get a chance to exploit them and hopefully get your positive command and control. That's a watering hole attack. The idea is you take a website your target visits and poison it so anybody who visits it gets exploited as well. So, how do we set up a watering hole attack? Well, one option, I suppose you could hack into a web server and change the HTML of a file on the site to serve your malware. That is an option. Another option is you can look for a cross-site scripting opportunity. There are two kinds of cross-site scripting opportunities. Reflective cross-site scripting lets you specify code to inject into a website as part of a parameter in a URL. The trick with reflective cross-site scripting is it only applies to anybody who clicks that specially crafted URL. But these are great for phishing attacks because somebody will click that link thinking it's a legitimate website. Another option is persistent cross-site scripting. If you have an opportunity to embed arbitrary HTML onto a website, you can serve exploits to anybody who visits that website. The easiest way to do this is to embed an iframe into the site that points to your favorite exploit. Okay, let's take a look at a watering hole attack. Here's a website, presumably something my target visits. It's a wiki. This is TWiki. What's cool about TWiki is anybody can edit a page and put whatever HTML they like. Let me put in some bolded text, press preview, and we can see that my bolded text shows up. TWiki does not do any sanitization of the data. Now, let's set up a web drive-by attack. Let's go to attacks, web drive-by, smart applet attack. The smart applet attack is a Cobalt Strike version of several popular Java exploits. It's an applet. When it's run, it will determine which version of Java the user has. If the version of Java is vulnerable to a Java exploit, the smart app attack will disable the Java security sandbox and run my code for me. So let's use a Meterpreter listener, and let's go ahead and launch this. Here we have the smart app attack running at this particular URL. Great. Now let's go back to TWiki. Let's save the changes here and hit edit again. Let's add an iframe. We'll do iframe source equals, paste in the URL to our smart app attack. And let's add a closing iframe tag, preview it, and save it. Now, anybody that visits this wiki page will get served the Cobalt Strike smart app attack. If we go to view weblog, we can see that I, the attacker, have actually loaded the smart app attack twice. But my browser's not running Java, so I'm somewhat safe. Now let's grab that URL, show Cobalt Strike, and let's go back to our target system. And let's go visit the TWiki page. By visiting the TWiki page, I, the target, am silently loading the Cobalt Strike smart app attack. It's the legitimate TWiki page, but by going there, Cobalt Strike is attempting to exploit their browser. And you can see it did. We have a Meterpreter session. We have positive control over this target system. That's a watering hole attack, and this is quite popular with advanced threat actors. Watering hole attacks are kind of dangerous. If I'm hired as a pen tester and I come in and deface my client's website and serve malware to their visitors, rightfully so, they're probably not going to like me very much. Maybe I could get away with it for an internal website. Another option, though, is for me, the attacker, to clone a legitimate website, embed an exploit into that clone site, point a domain to that clone site, and send that to a target in a phishing email. This is one way to dress up an attack. Let's go ahead and take a look at it. Okay, here we are in Cobalt Strike again. Let's set up an exploit. Let's go to attacks, web drive-by, and we'll do the signed app attack. Why not? And we'll make this one deliver Meterpreter again. Let's press launch. We now have the Cobalt Strike signed applet attack running at this particular URL. Great. Now, let's clone a website. Let's go to attacks, web drive-by, clone site. And we'll clone the Cobalt Strike website. We'll clone advancedpentest.com. To embed an exploit, press dot 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 here and choose the attack to embed. If you like, you can change this information to a fully qualified domain name. That's okay. You can do that here. Or you can leave it as is. It's up to you. We're going to clone the Cobalt Strike website. If I want, I can log keystrokes on it as well. But let's go ahead and press clone. We now have a cloned website running at this URL. Let's go visit it with a target system. Let's go to Windows 7. Let's go click on our link, and you can see the Cobalt Strike page loading, and I'm being prompted whether or not I want to run this Java application. I'll accept the risk and press run. And by doing so, I've given the attacker access to my system. But I'm looking at what looks like a legitimate website. So that's an example of dressing up an attack with Cobalt Strike. Okay, just a moment ago, we went through the exercise of setting up a phishing site. Great. A phishing site does no good, though, unless we actually lure somebody to it. Spear phishing is a great way to get somebody to open your content or visit your exploit. How do we spear phish with Cobalt Strike? Follow these steps. Step 1, create a target list. Step 2, create or reuse a template. Step 3, choose a mail server to send through. Step 4, send it. Cobalt Strike spear phishing templates are saved emails. I have a philosophy. Hacking tools produce lousy looking emails. If you're going pro, take an existing email and repurpose it. Here is a LinkedIn invitation. Most webmail clients will let you view the message source. In the case of Hotmail and Gmail, just go to the arrow next to reply, click view message source. Here's what an email looks like in the raw. This is your template. You can edit it a little bit though. Cobalt Strike has several template tokens, things that are replaced before a message is sent. You can use %URL% to replace an embedded URL. You can use %toName to specify the name of the target and personalize your phish, or %to to put in the email address of your target. Now, what do you use as a mail server? One of my favorite things to do is just to pull the mail exchanger record for my target's domain and relay messages to them through their mail server. This usually works just fine. Now, when you go to send a message, here's the dialogue that you'll use. You'll point Cobalt Strike to your target's file, point it to your template, attach a file, or embed a URL, or both. Set up the mail server you want Cobalt Strike to use. Set an address Cobalt Strike should tell the mail server to bounce messages to if something goes wrong, and press send. Okay, let's take a look at spear phishing with Cobalt Strike. Step 1, create a targets file. I'm going to open a terminal, and don't laugh, but I'm going to use Pico to create a targets file. And Cobalt Strike targets files are nothing more than one email address per line. Okay, so I can specify multiple email addresses. And if I want to take advantage of those tokens to personalize the email, I can use a tab to separate the email address from the user's actual name. So that's pretty convenient. So we have a targets file. Great. Now we need a template. Here, this is my Outlook spam account. And I found a message which is a newsletter subscription. Perfect. If I send that to somebody, maybe they will try to unsubscribe and go to my malicious website. So one way to repurpose a message is to get the raw message source. The way you do that in Outlook is go to More Commands, View Message Source. This is a potential email template. Let's go to File, Save Page As. Actually, let's just do this. Control A, right click, copy. And let's just put this in a file called newyorktimes.message. Oops. Paste. The extension doesn't matter. I'm just a perfectionist. So there we go. We now have a template file. Great. Now, let's go ahead and set up our email. Let's go to Cobalt Strike, Attacks, Spearfish. Let's choose our targets file, in this case, targets.txt. Let's choose our template, newyorktimes.message. Let's choose to embed a URL. We can embed our cloned website from a moment ago. So let's just go ahead and press dot, 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 and choose the cloned website. If you want, you can change this to a fully qualified domain name right here. That's perfectly acceptable. I've already configured my mail server. It's 192.168.1.107. If I need to log into a mail server, press dot, dot, dot. I can specify the host, the port, the username, password. I can also specify whether or not to have a random delay of how many seconds or up to how many seconds between messages to avoid tripping filters. And I could specify a bounce address as an address I control. Now, before I send this message, let's hit preview. This shows me how Cobalt Strike puts the message together. We can see that the 2 has been set to Jim Stevens. The date has been updated for us. And a bunch of headers were stripped out as well. The plain text version of the message was not changed. You can use %URL to do that if you like. But if we scroll down into the HTML version, we can see that all the links were changed to our malicious website. So cool, I'm good with that. Let's hit close and let's hit send. Cobalt Strike will send the message off, and we can see that the message was queued for both users, so that's good. Now, let's take a look at this from the user's perspective. Here we are, and we've got a victim system, and we can see we've got a message from the New York Times. Let's double-click it to open. Now, of course, this mail client is not displaying images by default, but if I hit display images, that looks pretty good. That's a pixel-perfect fish, right? Now, let's redeem the special offer. I click on it, and I'm brought to the Cobalt Strike website, and if I allow this applet to run, I will have given the attacker access to my system. So that's an example of spear phishing with Cobalt Strike. So in this lecture, we talked about social engineering and how to deliver an attack package to a target. We talked about physical media, watering hole attacks, we went through how to create a phishing site, and I showed you how to do spear phishing with Cobalt Strike. This concludes Lecture 4, Social Engineering.